was here Record People's Era. It's in the vault. I mean, you must go buy other stuff to get to this stuff in the vault. Where exactly is it, like behind the mayonnaise? I mean, where in the vault? I mean, you guys have been together how many years now?
22 or 23 years.
So at some point in those, you just pass by this stuff. There's other stuff. Where in the vault is this stuff?
The vault, you take a left at the Fortress of Solitude.
Oh, I see.
And the vault is the next door to the right.
I see. I see.
And that's where Kiss keeps their stuff. We split the rent with Superman.
I see.
Well, we actually really save almost everything.
Yeah.
We're anal only in that way. We save every piece of Kisstory we can get our hands on. Right. It includes fan memorabilia. So almost any live show that we've done, especially in the 70s, we have locked up in vaults.
So why now? At what point? Why not after 15 years? Why not after 8? Why not 30? Why not wait 6-7 years more? Why now?
I think you know, when we did the Unplug thing for MTV, that was the first time the four of us had played together in well over 15 years. And I think when we realized the magic was still there, I thought everybody kind of figured maybe there was a shot at maybe putting the makeup back on and making it work again.
We really, you know, we separated and parted company in a haze of ego, drugs, alcohol, and all the other ills that go along with
it. And that would be a haze.
That is definitely a haze.
I mean, that really is. You know, any one of those is a haze on itself. And when you put them all together, that's pieces.
Well, it's very interesting because you have four people's perception of how it ended, and it's all very different, but you know, we swore we would never do this again. Most of us said we had no interest in getting back together. But I think what we were really saying was we had no interest in getting back together if we were going to feel about each other the way we did when we split. But when we got together and did Unplugged, it really became apparent to us that everybody had grown. Everybody was straight, clear-headed. And actually, instead of recreating the past, we could pick up where we left off. And I think nowadays, more than ever, people are ready for entertainment. When we were originally on the scene,
be up with people, singers.
I think we are. We always have been committed, but not in the way with the men with the white suits. Those are all.
I think we're ready. We'll be ready for that in a couple of years.
Yeah. How did you all get? And why did you decide to even do MTV Unplugged? Did you see other artists and think that was it, or what was the reason?
See, I got together with Gene and Paul before that. They were doing a Kiss convention in L.A. I wanted to bring my daughter.
The Kiss Convention was a traveling museum that we took through America and Australia, where people got a chance to spend 9 hours with the band and to see really a retrospective of costumes, a lot of the vintage equipment. Then at one point there would be a tribute band in makeup doing a 70s-style Kiss show. And then we came out and did an acoustic set. And that was really the start or the seed that sprouted into Unplugged.
That to me was actually the beginning of, I felt it starting when the three of us got together with Alex.
You played at the convention.
Yeah, sang at the convention, and we actually did Harlock Woman.
And then we should bring Ace into it.
I was a little hesitant and nervous about it. I didn't know how it was going to be walking into SIR, Studio Instrument Rentals in New York, you know, the first day of rehearsals where we haven't played, and I wasn't sure what kind of vibe it was going to be, but I honestly have to say, you know, after 5 minutes, it was like 15 years had just disappeared, and, you know, it was like old times. Gee, and the chemistry was still there, Jay.
Yeah. Who caught on first, Europe or America?
Detroit.
So that would be another whole country altogether.
Yes. That's a world
unto
itself.
So neither Europe or America, just Detroit, really.
We came out off the streets of New York, and we love New York, and it's always been our hometown. We started off at the end of 73, early 74, but by the beginning of 75, we were headlining big halls in Detroit, and they were the first city that caught on, and which is one of the reasons why Paul wrote a song called Detroit Rock City.
Well, let me ask you this. In the early days, did magazines agree not to publish photos of you guys?
They really did.
Because, you know, that seems like something that would be impossible today. I mean, nowadays, it's like any scoop, anything, hard copy, all these shows. Because I remember, I wonder what those guys look like. And I never, ever saw any photos.
We did have...
We got tricked once, right? We got tricked one time.
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Cream.
There was a sort of a cat and mouse game. If we'd go to a restaurant with a starlet or whoever we were going out with at the time, they'd be waiting for us outside, but always at a sort of a respectful distance. It's a sort of a different paparazzi.
Well, see, that's amazing to me. And the fact that the FBI can't get them, CBS, not to publish photos of the Unabomber. Yet you guys...
There you go. On the other hand, the Unabomber is not very good live. He just, I mean, he blows things up, but there's no music. We blow things up, but we play rock and roll all night.
Now, what did Cream do to burn you?
They lied. They said our manager, right?
We were young, inexperienced. We walked into a magazine called Cream Magazine, which was very big at the time in Michigan, and met everybody, and they said, can we take your photo without makeup? We said, absolutely not. You know, we're KISS, and we believe in the magic and the mystique, and the fans do not want to see us without makeup. Somebody comes in and says, I just got off the phone with Bill O'Coin, their manager. He says, okay, you can take one photo only without makeup. And we look at each other, and we go, okay. Okay, duh.
Now, all the explosions during the shows, any close calls, anything?
In Lakeland, Florida, I was... You know, we had the large set with the staircase coming down, and I would walk down anyway. I touched the metal railing, and I got hit with 220 volts, and I had all burns on my fingers, and they had to carry me off. I was out for about 10 minutes, and Paul went out and made an announcement saying, you know, we may not...
Because there were guitarists in the house.
Yeah, could somebody get up and... Does anybody know how to play his licks? But eventually what happened was I came out of the...
You were a trooper.
I came out of it, and the kids started chanting Ace, 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 and my adrenaline started pumping again, and I finished the show even though I had no feeling in my hand.
How did you decide on the makeup exactly and the different characters? I mean, you just...
We all created our own characters, and basically they're all our alter egos, you know. I was always fascinated with science fiction and space travel, you know. Gene was always into old monster films and stuff, and... You know, we all kind of created our own characters and designed our own.
I mean, is
it
something you came
costumes?
Up with? You said, let's think of something. Okay, and that was it?
Or
did you think about it for weeks? I mean, did it take weeks to come up with it? Or was just instantaneous?
It,
yeah, here's what I want to be.
Actually, most of it.
It evolved over a couple of months before we kind of got the initial designs down. And then if you look at pictures from the very first album cover, and then look maybe 5 or 6 albums down, the makeup kind of got a little more perfected.
We were always trying to become the band that we never saw.
does the book of groupie photos come out as a book? That seems like that would be a piece of history that should somehow not be in the vault.
In all seriousness, it's a private, it's sort of a tourist's guide to the galaxy. Why take a shot of anywhere you haven't been to? So the point of view on that, it's a very romantic book. To everybody else, it's a kind of a circus.
It's a romantic book.
Absolutely. I see it as a very...
How is it romantic?
It's the mementos of memorable points in my life. And television...
Each one lasted about 45 minutes.
Other people call it a livestock show. I mean,
it would be romantic.
No, I mean, I think people on the outside see this as swinging from the chandeliers, but... That's not true, because hotels don't have chandeliers.
They don't have that anymore.
No, they don't have that. No, not anymore.
It must be gratifying that, so many contemporary artists credit you guys as an influence.
The cool thing with a lot of people who've been influenced by us is that they're not mere copies of us. And I think the ultimate compliment is when somebody cites you as an influence, but then goes on to develop their own style. It's great that you can have a Garth, a Lenny Kravitz, people who you wouldn't see a direct, you know, influence. But, I mean, that's the ultimate compliment, is that there's all these groups around and people that somehow this virus has seemed to permeate, this KISS virus.
I think every artist has a responsibility to show anybody else they've influenced that they're just another chapter in the book of rock and roll. There's somebody before and somebody's going to come after.
Let me ask something. With the whole makeup thing, did you guys ever do the show in makeup, quickly take it off, and then go wander through the crowd just to get reactions? I mean, or would you have been... Because you weren't... especially in the early days, immediately recognized.
I wandered through the crowd. I remember one day somewhere in a show down south, a friend of mine had flown in, and I was walking through the audience prior to us going on. But nobody knew who I was, because at that point in time, nobody knew what we looked like, and we hadn't been photographed without makeup. And that was a kick.
It was pretty obvious that we walked to an airport with heels this big and, you know, really different clothes than we were. It was pretty, you know, it's hard not to notice that.
There was always this misconception people had that we had this duality, this Clark Kent Superman identity. And the fact of the matter was, even without the makeup, when you saw somebody walking down the street with blue-black hair and 6-inch heels and 6.5 feet tall, either the circus was in town or it was a member of KISS. So there wasn't a whole lot of anonymity.
And what did groupies prefer, makeup on or makeup off?
both?
Good question. There were certainly ones that... incidentally, why do you always look at me when you bring up the question? You immediately turn... Now, Gene, tell me about what... So, there were certainly girls who just sort of wanted a night of pleasure and so on, and other ones who wanted the fantasy, you know, leave it on. And
please.
Please leave it on.
How is the night of fantasy different from the night of pleasure? I'm trying to figure out what
the
difference is.
Well, the fantasy, if we do our job right, becomes pleasure, but I think some, you know, sometimes people, and I certainly want the same from girls. I don't want women to appear in my room nude immediately. I want the stiletto heels, the corset. I want
that. And then you'll take it off.
You want that. 8 seconds of romance.
I'll take it off.
It's so good.
You got it? Son of a bitch. He's making the jokes.
You know, he just goes on.
He knows.
No, but I think fantasy is every bit as important to anything. Dressing up is half the fun. And the rest is just digging for gold.
I'm taking it off.
The song Rock and Roll All Night, Party Every Day, that was the first breakthrough hit. Did that really change things? Is that the song that changed things for you?
At that point, the president of our record company sat us down and said, you guys need a song that really states what you believe in. And it was completely Greek to us. And we said, what are you talking about? And he told us about a song by Sly and the Family Stone. And he was talking about a rallying song, something that the crowd would be able to say, this is what I believe in, this is what the band believes in. And in Los Angeles, we went back to the hotel, and I came up with a chorus, I want to rock and roll all night and party every day. And Gene came up with the verse, and there you have it. And it really was a turning point, because on Kiss Alive, it was the song that, I guess people really, you know, it was like a battle cry. Everybody said, this is who I am. This is what I believe in.
Tell me about the early influences. Who were the early influences for you guys starting out? You know, you're putting the band together.
Beatles, Stones, Led Zeppelin. I was into jazz, actually, a lot of jazz. The big band, swing.
I used to open for jazz. Stan Getz, Mose Allison, wow. Amon Jamal.
Great stuff, Jay.
Miles. I used to open for Miles.
My parents played jazz in the house all my life, and I grew up on it. And matter of fact, when I got in the band, I was more of a jazz drummer. I believe I was a rock and roll drummer.
What did your parents think of Kiss early on? Did they go, what are you doing? What are you doing with the makeup thing? Straighten yourself out, boy. What's the matter with you?
No, you're like some kind of... to make the costumes, help make the costumes, come to rehearsals. She was very supportive.
Mom made the costumes. Dad had the barn. What the hell? Let's put on a kid show. Yeah, come on, everybody.
Judy
Garland. Get the neighborhood kids. And look at it, Mickey Rooney. Look at...
I got an Irish mom and Italian father. He's always screaming in the house.
Yeah, I'm the Scotch Italian, so I understand that.
I remember when I was 16, I cut school one day and I went to see the Murray the K show, and it was Mitch Ryder was the headliner, and lo and behold, the opening acts were Cream and The Who. It was their first New York appearance. Oh. And when I saw Pete Townsend smash his amplifier and smash his guitar, and Keith Moon wreck his drum kit and smoke bombs go off, I said, wow, that's incredible. I go, I know I can do that. I'd love to be in a theatrical rock group. You know, and then, you know, as time went on, groups like Alice Cooper came out, the New York Dolls, and we just decided to take it a step further.
In rock and roll, as in what I do, it's fun making it, and it's fun to see the figure of how much you make. But once you make it, you don't really care about it.
Very early on, you have enough. And once you have enough money, then all it gives you the opportunity to do is to stop worrying about the money and to do what you do as good as possible. So the money becomes irrelevant very, very quickly, and then pride becomes much more important.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're going to be miserable, all the money in the world, I mean, it's just not enough. If it's just a nightmare every day, I would give all that up to be happy.
Do you miss the intimacy of a club in the big stadium, or is the big stadium just that much more of a rush?
I've just been clubs for enough years. I don't miss them. Yeah. I don't miss them when I go, and it's great to be back in big arenas. I love it. I didn't like the clubs at all, I'll be real honest.
I think most of the time when people say how great it is playing clubs, it's usually because they can't fill an arena.
Yeah.
You know, it's nice to go do a club once in a while to get a taste of that, but anybody who says that the clubs are the way to go clearly can't find their way into a stadium and arena, and more power to them. But the reality is that what we do translates and transfers very well to a large audience. And I think we're at our best in a large arena rather than a small one.
I mean, you play the clubs. To me, they're bars. They're a bunch of drunks. No one really cares. They're shooting pool. You're up there singing your heart out. You're playing your heart out. I didn't like it. I did it for a while, and it's great to be back with these guys. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it's, I didn't, you know, the clubs, you could take them and shove them. I don't miss them. It's just not cool. You're freezing your ass off half the time. The amps don't work. People are not even there all the time.
And that clubs Adam guy.
Clubs are hard.
When I played in stadiums, I wasn't able to see the audience very well. And then I realized that my eyesight was starting to go.
Hey, let me ask you this.
So I got contacts last week, so now I'm really going to enjoy playing again.
How does one find the edge after all these years and being comfortable, making money, being successful, this, that? Now you go out again. If I come to you and go, okay, I'm like 18 or I'm 15, why should I listen to you? What's the edge? Show me where my edge is. I mean, all the bands that are like way, way out there. How do you get the edge back?
Edge starts with self. Doesn't matter how many bones you've got through your noses or how many razor blades you've got in your eyes. That's all outer surface stuff. That's style and fashion. If you've got something to prove to yourself, that's all the edge you need. It's the same adrenaline and stuff that makes a fighter go into a ring and become the world champion. And if you've got something to prove to yourself, that's all the edge you need. We are so pumped up about going out there and showing everybody that what they've heard all these years isn't just a fairy tale, that there is a Kiss, there once was a Kiss, and we're going to knock your socks off. We're going to get up there and prove, literally, we're going to show all the bands out there how the big boys do it.
Just a world tour or just the United States? Or?
The tour has real long-range plans, and as long as it's fun for us, we're going to keep coming back to visit our friends.
And you're invited.